Hey guys, you're probably here because you want to know all about how to get better from the cold or the flu. We're talking about symptoms such as headaches, runny noses, sore throats, blocked noses, fever, muscle aches, everything, every kind of symptom from the cold or the flu. We're going to talk about in this video and how you can get better from it, because as you know, winter is coming. Sorry, I had to say that. I couldn't resist. Let's crack on. Now, this is going to be quite a long video, jam-packed full of information, and I know you're a busy person. So if you want any specific information, the video is going to be chaptered below. Feel free to click on the description, click on whatever information you want. However, as I always say, I'd highly recommend that you watch the entire video. That way, you're gonna become a bit of a pro. Let's carry on. Okay, so let's begin with the signs and symptoms of a cold or the flu. Now, they do share a lot of symptoms, the two of them. When we have a mild cold, we usually have symptoms like a blocked nose, sometimes a runny nose, sometimes the opposite. We have a sore throat, we can have a bit of a temperature. These are quite normal, mild symptoms. When we're looking at heavier symptoms of a cold, we're talking about things like pain around the body and the muscle ache type stuff, headaches, pain around the sinuses. These are all quite normal to have on a heavy bout of cold, but they do share a lot of symptoms. Now, at the time of recording this video, we are going through the COVID-19 pandemic, and unfortunately they do share symptoms with COVID-19 as well. So please remember, I'm sure you all know this already, but if you have any of these symptoms, such as a persistent cough, if you have a temperature, or if you have any loss of smell or taste, this could be COVID-19. And I'm going to leave loads more information in the description below on the latest guidance on what you should do if you have these symptoms. As you know, this stuff is changing quite constantly, so it's good to probably look in the description to stay up to date with it. Now, if you're watching this video and you do have a bit of a cold or the flu, the good news is that most people recover within a week or two, but there are many things that you can do to help aid the recovery and help you get better sooner. So that is exactly what we're going to talk about in this video. So that's all the signs and symptoms bit done. Let's talk about what you can actually do. So let's begin with probably one of the most common symptoms of a cold or the flu, which is usually a sore throat or a cough. What is the best treatment? What should you do for it? Well, we're going to discuss that now. Well, first of all, you need to make sure that you're drinking plenty of water. I know water sounds basic, but it's critical for our body to produce saliva, flush out waste, produce hormones, and keep our cells functioning. And that's just a few of the things that it does. When you're well, you should be trying to stay hydrated anyway, but this becomes even more important when we're ill. Now, taking regular sips of water can help soothe your throat and helps thin any of your body's excess mucus that could be irritating you and causing you to cough. You should try and aim for about 8 glasses of fluid a day. Now, another top tip that you can also try is gargling salt water. We call the salt water a saline solution, or a saline rinse, or a saline gargle. Saline is basically salt water. You can make that at home, and it's really, really good for getting rid of excess mucus and providing temporary relief as well for the sore throat and potentially stopping the coughing as well. And if you want to know how to make a saline rinse or a saline salt water solution, whatever you want to call it, it's super easy. All you need to do, boil the kettle, and also it's super inexpensive, by the way, sorry. Boil the kettle, get a pint glass, let it cool a little, then pour it into your pint glass. Obviously, if it's too hot, it's probably gonna smash the glass, by the way. After that, get a teaspoon of salt. Only use about half a teaspoon of salt. Pour it in there, give it a mix, let it cool, so obviously you're not gonna burn yourself. And once it's cool to a temperature which you're easy with, which you're not gonna burn with, you can then gargle. Make sure you do it over the sink, gargle away, and then spit it out. Try not to swallow any of the solution. Obviously, sometimes you might swallow a little bit. It's not gonna harm you, but try not to swallow it. Also, I'd highly recommend this is only done by adults. Children shouldn't really be doing it. And that's it, really. It's as simple as that. Another top tip for a sore throat or a cough is eating soft foods. Also, people find that eating colder foods help, such as eating ice lollies or sucking on lollipops or boiled sweets. All of these things can help kind of create that suction action, which is gonna help get rid of that mucus and any irritation in the throat. A lot of people find this really, really helpful. Another thing that you can do for a cough, for example, is put in 2 teaspoons of honey in some hot water in a mug. Give it a stir and drink it slowly. Obviously, again, let it cool a little so you're not going to burn yourself. A lot of people find this really helpful, and it's probably as effective, if not more effective, than some of the cough medicines that you can buy over the counter in the supermarket or in the chemist's. Now, I really hope these tips are helping you so far, but if you've tried all these tips so far for your sore throat and cough and you're still coughing or your throat is still quite sore, there are other options available as well, which are more medicinal options. I usually start with the more easy options that everyone can do at home. home because most people probably don't have these medicines at home, but I think paracetamol and ibuprofen can be really effective for these, and most people have them at home. Please do speak to your chemist before you take them so you can make sure that you're safe and suitable to take that medication. That is the most important thing. And also always read the information leaflet that comes with the medication again to check that you are safe and suitable to take it. Again, I'm going to say it again, that's the most important thing because your health is the most important thing. Now, some patients also find that sucking on a medicated lozenge can be quite helpful for them. By the way, lozenges are basically boiled sweets. They're the hard little sweets that you suck on. You can get medicated ones that contain antiseptics. We'll leave the ingredients here. Look out for these ingredients on the back of it. If they are there, it'd be useful for you to try them if the other stuff haven't really worked so far. And if all of that still doesn't work and you're still having a bit of a sore throat and it's getting really, really tiresome, then you can try local anesthetic sprays. And some lozenges actually have local anesthetics as well. And that's going to help numb the area and help reduce the pain. But please be aware that if you do use a local anesthetic, it can make the whole mouth numb. It's kind of like going to the dentist after you have some work done and your whole mouth is numb because of the local anesthetic. And when that happens, you're at much higher risk of burning yourself, for example, when you have a hot cup of tea, because you're not going to feel it. Those nerve endings are not as sensitive as what they used to be. And you probably won't even tell that it's burning. So just be aware of that if you're having hot drinks or if you're doing the salt water gargling, etc. These sort of local anesthetic products, look out for ingredients like benzocaine, lidocaine. These all end in cane, remember that. The benzocaines, all that family are local anesthetics basically. So if you see them on the actual product, the lozenges or the sprays, that basically means there's a local anesthetic in there. Okay, so how are you doing so far? I hope you're finding this information helpful. If you are, make sure to click on that like button and just leave a comment to say, you know what, I'm finding this information helpful. Now, let's move on to how to get rid of that blocked nose, runny nose, catarrh, phlegm, mucus, all that stuff in the nasal area is what we're talking about now. The first thing that I'm gonna mention to you is probably one of the best things that you can try for it. And again, this is gonna be the saline rinse. You can use the solution that we used for the gargling to do a saline rinse. I'm gonna explain how we do it in a minute. So it's that same solution that you can use. Again, let it cool down a little, but you can use that exact same solution. And it's gonna help get rid of that mucus. It's gonna help get rid of any inflammation in that area, anything nasty that's causing that inflammation and mucus to build up there. It's just gonna help to get rid of it so you can breathe easier. Now, surprisingly, a blocked nose is not often caused by mucus, but it's actually caused by the blood vessels in your nasal passage and them expanding. They expand so that more white blood cells can fight off any infection there. But this translates to that uncomfortable and annoying feeling that we all have when we have a blocked nose where we're unable to breathe from our nose and then we become mouth breathers. Now, when doing the saline rinse, it's really easy to do. We spoke about the solution earlier, how to make it. Again, I'm going to leave more information in the description on how to make a saline rinse also if you'd like to read it and just come back to this. But it's really simple. You're going to stand over the sink because it's very messy. And you're going to get the pint glass with your solution in it, pour it in the palm of your hand and suck it in from one nostril and then just let it fall out. Okay, and you're going to do that a few times in one nostril and a few times in another nostril. Again, you can do this several times in a day. There's no maximum amount, by the way, for the gargling or the saline rinse through the nose. You can do it as much as you want just to get that relief throughout the day. If you're finding it difficult to make the saline rinse solution, there are ready-made solutions that you can buy in the chemist or supermarket. So these are other options as well. Another option to discuss as well are nasal decongestants. These can be quite helpful when you've got congestion, but remember that you get something called rebound congestion from them, which after using them, I think it's for more than 5 or 7 days, sometimes it can cause rebound congestion. So it actually makes you more congested than you were in the first place. It's not something you want to be using long term. Also, decongestants interact with quite a lot of medicines. And also, if you have like heart problems, for example, you shouldn't be using them. This is why it's super important that you speak to your healthcare professional, your pharmacist especially, before you purchase them, just so they can question you and make sure that you are safe and suitable to use it. And again, read the information leaflet again, just to make sure you're safe and suitable to use it. I know I keep saying this, but your health is the most important thing. Now, an alternative to nasal sprays, or you can be using in addition actually, are vapor rubs. These contain things like eucalyptus or menthol, and it can again help to open up the airways and help you breathe easier. Sometimes they come as rubs where you can place them on things, so it helps. You can just breathe it in throughout the day, or you can also mix them in hot water and do steam inhalation with them. Okay, so now we're on to the next section. We're looking at headaches, muscle aches, and temperatures. What can you do to help with these? Well, it's pretty simple. You need to make sure that you're resting and giving your body time to recover. You can also take paracetamol or ibuprofen, as these medicines are not only painkillers that can help with headaches, but are also known as something called antipyretics. This means that they're good at bringing down a fever and can stop the discomfort of feeling hot and shivery. But again, please speak to your healthcare professional before you take any of these medicines so they make sure that you're safe and suitable to take them. So a high temperature is anything above 38 degrees Celsius. Now, another top tip that you can do, which is gonna help with a fever, that high temperature, is drinking plenty of fluid. I know we spoke about it earlier, but again, this is again gonna help with bringing down a fever. Remember, when you've got a fever as well, you're gonna be losing a lot more water, your body's gonna be working a lot harder. So again, by drinking fluids and making sure that you're well hydrated, this is going to help. And dehydration can quite often cause headaches. So again, this is another win-win situation. We're actually drinking plenty of water, so 8 glasses of water a day. By the way, other drinks count to this as well. So if you're having coffee or tea, these also count to that 8 glasses a day. But again, dehydration can cause a headache, so make sure you are staying hydrated. And do just make sure that you're wearing loose, comfortable clothes. You haven't got too many layers on if you have a fever, because your body needs some air. It needs to get rid of that temperature. Fans and air conditioning or anything like that blowing on you, there's no evidence that this is going to help reduce your internal body temperature. Yes, it will reduce your surface body temperature, but it's really not going to do much for your internal body temperature. For that, we need to make sure we're wearing the right clothes, reduce our layers, make sure you're wearing loose clothes, all that sort of stuff. Now, we've discussed a few things about headaches so far. So we discussed the hydration, the paracetamol and ibuprofen, but there are a few other things that you can do as well which will help with this. The first thing that you need to avoid is alcohol, because alcohol not only dehydrates you, which can make headaches worse, but it also widens the blood vessels in your brain and causes an increase in blood flow there. This can cause headaches and even trigger migraines in people who are prone to them. And on top of this, alcohol has been shown to have the ability to suppress the immune system and interfere with your body's natural recovery process. In short, this means that drinking alcohol could make it longer to get better. So while you're recovering from a headache or any other illness, stay clear of any alcoholic drinks to get better sooner. Now, another thing that you really need to try and avoid is skipping meals, because I know when you're not feeling well, you really don't want to have a meal, okay? But it's super important that you're having your 3 meals a day. This is gonna make sure that our sugar levels are at a normal steady state, because if it does drop, our body produces certain hormones which tighten the blood vessels to the brain, which again can lead to headaches as well. And the final tip for headaches is, when you are unwell, I know what you're probably gonna do. You're gonna watch TV, you're gonna play on your laptop, you're gonna play on these all day, you're gonna be looking at it all day, and that's gonna strain the eyes. And by straining the eyes, it's gonna cause headaches as well. So you need to try and keep it a normal amount on these, on the phones, on the laptops, on the TV, and every now and then have a rest. That's just gonna give your eyes time to adjust again and reduce your chance of that headache, which is really, really not nice when you're not feeling well. Now, with colds and the flu, most people can usually recover on their own without having to speak to the healthcare professional. However, there are certain people who are much more vulnerable and could potentially get really, really unwell. And I'd highly recommend that these people do speak to the healthcare professional. It should already be here, a box full of these individuals who are what we call more vulnerable people. So if you are any of these, or if you know someone who's any of these that you're looking after right now, make sure that you speak to their healthcare professional, or you speak to your healthcare professional. Now, there are also certain symptoms that you need to look out for, which should prompt you to speak to your healthcare professional sooner as well. So these include, for example, if you feel like you're not getting any better and your symptoms have suddenly got worse, if you feel like you've got a really, really high temperature, or if you're having shivering because of your temperature or chills, again, this should prompt you to speak to your healthcare professional. And in terms of recovery time with a cold, if you've not got any better after 3 weeks, and with a flu, if you haven't got any better after 7 days, both of these, you need to speak to your healthcare professional. There are also more emergency times when you need to speak to a healthcare professional. Little box is going to appear here. Give it a read, just so you know that you need to seek medical advice urgently if you have any of these. And one last point when it comes to seeking medical advice, look, we're all different. So sometimes we might not apply to all the stuff that I've just discussed, but you know yourself better than anyone else. And if you feel like something's not right and you're not doing too well, just pick up the phone and speak to your healthcare professional. That's the best and safest option, just to get some professional healthcare advice. Can be really, really important. So that's the end of this week's video. We now know all about colds and flu and all about the symptoms and what you can do to get better, quicker, and give you some relief from those symptoms as well. You also know all about when you should seek medical advice. So you're a bit of a cold and flu symptom pro, if you want to call it that. Please do let us know how you get on. And also, if you have any of your own tips, please leave a comment below because I'd love to read it. And I'm sure everyone watching this video would too. Always remember you're awesome and I will see you next week. Hey guys, thanks for watching this week's video. Make sure to click that like, follow or subscribe button now to stay up to date with new weekly videos.